With carbohydrates, we've long ago left behind the mathematics of inorganic chemistry. We've left behind the nomenclature and reactions of organic chemistry, and we're into an area that's more descriptive. And that's good news for you, but at the same time, it makes it difficult to predict what might be on the exams. And there are two resources that I'd like you to keep in mind. The tutor review, where we've tried to narrow down the material to emphasize the important skills and concepts. And then the other resource are the learning objectives at the start of each chapter. The start of chapter 7, carbohydrate chemistry, there are 10 learning objectives that are listed, and we'll cover two of those today. One of the important topics in carbohydrate chemistry is that of optical isomerism. If you remember, we introduced structural isomers back in chapter one, I think, of organic chemistry. And we also introduced geometric isomerism or cis-trans isomers following that. But we find an important kind of isomerism called optical isomerism. And it's illustrated by a simple carbohydrate, glyceraldehyde. There are three carbons, so it's a triose. There's an oxygen or a functional group on each carbon that's characteristic of carbohydrates. And what we find is that glyceraldehyde can exhibit two forms, and that these two forms are simply mirror images of one another. But they're isomers. They have the same structural, same kind of structure. They have the same molecular formula. That's what I was searching for. The same sequence of bonding, and yet we find that there are two isomeric forms. If you envision a mirror plane here, these two forms are simply mirror images of one another. In this structure, I've drawn the OH sort of pointing toward the mirror, and its mirror image would also point toward the mirror. And if we were to take these two structures and build models of them, we'd find that we couldn't superimpose them, that they're unique structures, that they're not exactly the same. So in other words, they indeed are isomers. Much like our two hands, our left hand and our right hand have the same structural features, and yet we can't superimpose them. There's no way I can make a left hand into a right hand. When something exhibits optical isomerism, we refer to the structures as optical isomers, and the feature that we believe gives rise to this kind of isomerism is when carbon has four different groups or four collections of atoms attached to it. And those are called chiral carbon atoms. And here I've marked this atom with an asterisk. And one of the skills, one of the learning objectives for this chapter in carbohydrates is to be able to identify chiral carbon atoms and predict when optical isomerism would exist. Let's look at this structure again. Here I've redrawn the structure of glyceraldehyde to emphasize the chiral carbon at the middle. And I've circled each of these four atoms or collections of atoms that are unique. And what we're looking at is not simply the atom that's attached to the chiral carbon, but the whole collection of atoms through that bond. So here we have a hydrogen, an oxygen, or an OH in this collection, obviously very different. Then the other two both have a carbon attached. But when we look at the entire collection, up here we have a CHO, and that differs from this group down here. So this carbon is a chiral carbon, and so glyceraldehyde exhibits optical isomerism. It's a kind of isomerism that's tremendously important for living structures and gives rise to properties of proteins and enzymes that we'll study later on. Okay, well, let's look at some other structures and see if we can predict when optical isomerism exists. Or in other words, is there a chiral carbon present? Here's a simple alcohol, and let's see if it has four different groups about this carbon. To help us, let's draw it in an expanded way and show each of those four bonds. Well, I see an H, an OH, a collection of CH3 out here, but that is identical to this collection of CH3 atoms over here on the left. So this particular atom is not chiral. Let's change the structure just a little bit. Let's lengthen the chain by one carbon atom, and now again, draw it in an expanded way. An OH, an H, we've got two groups. Over here, the collection of CH3, and now everything to the right, even though it's attached to a carbon, is different from this collection on the left. This would be a chiral carbon, and this molecule would exhibit optical isomerism. There'd be two different isomers, in other words. Let's look at a ring structure. Rings are a little bit tough, but we'll be able to work our way through it. The only atom that really draws our attention is this one right here, where a CH3 is attached to that carbon on the ring. We know that there's also a hydrogen there, because remember, the magic number for carbon is four bonds. So if I were to leave the hydrogen out, we'd see one, two, three bonds. That must means that there must be a hydrogen there too. So H is different from CH3. Attached up here is a CH2, but on the other position is a CH2. They're exactly the same. And now we work our way around the ring. CH2 compares to CH2, and then finally they both reach the CH2 position at the same time. Or in other words, we don't have four different groups attached to this atom. It's not chiral. Let's look at another ring structure. This cyclic structure looks a little more like what we would encounter in the carbohydrate chapter. I've substituted an oxygen for one of those carbons. Actually, this is a pyranose ring system. And here's a carbon that looks to us like it might be chiral. Let's give it a test. There's a hydrogen there to make the fourth bond to this position, an OH. It's two different groups. If I go up, I encounter an oxygen. If I come down, I encounter a carbon. So we've got four different groups of atoms attached to that position. It's chiral. It's possible for molecules to have more than two chiral carbons. Glucose, for example, has four chiral carbons, we'll find out. Here's this particular structure has four carbons, so it would be a triose. This is an abbreviated form of an aldehyde here at the top, so we could also say that this is an aldose. It's an aldotriose. And there are two chiral carbons. Let's see if we can make sense of them. Here at the top, I've got a CHO. That's different than hydrogen, different than OH, and it's also different than all of this collection at the bottom. So this upper carbon is a chiral carbon. Same kind of analysis convinces us that this bottom carbon is chiral. H, OH, CH2OH differs from all of this collection at the top. Two chiral carbons in this molecule. And now let's go to a system where we, in two dimensions, we can show these chiral or molecules containing chiral carbons. It's called Fischer projections. This leads us to a second learning objective for this chapter on carbohydrates, being able to draw Fischer projections of molecules that contain chiral carbons. Here are the two structures now for glyceraldehyde. And down below, I've shown these two structures using Fischer projections. The intersection of a line stands for a carbon. So really, it's just sort of an abbreviated way of showing these molecules, but also understood as the three-dimensional structure. In a Fischer projection, the the H and the OH are sort of coming out of the plane of the blackboard like this, and the groups at the top and the bottom are behind the plane of the blackboard. So it gives it away, gives us a way of looking at the three-dimensional structure. And then because we have two isomers, it's nice if we can differentiate those so that we know which one we're talking about. If the OH on the chiral carbon is pointing to the right, it's called D. So this would be, it's a small capital D, D glyceraldehyde. Over here, the OH is pointing toward the mirror. It's pointing toward the left. This is L glyceraldehyde. And the way I remember this is that left begins with L, and that helps me. Let's look at a molecule now that's got more than one chiral carbon. Here's the structure of glucose. I mentioned that it's got four chiral carbons, and so we have four intersections of lines up here. It's really just an abbreviated way of showing the structure of glucose, and also a way of showing that these OHs and Hs have specific directions. Glucose, because of all of these chiral carbons, is one of 16 isomers. Eight of those isomers are D, and eight of those isomers are L. And we designate D and L in a structure that has more than one chiral carbon by looking at the bottom chiral carbon. So it's this one down here that determines whether it's D or L. OH pointing to the right, it's D, D glucose. If the OH points to the left, it's L glucose.